Welcome. My name is David Hall. I am the president of the University of the Virgin Islands, and I want to welcome all of you to this global outreach program with the focus on STEM. The University of the Virgin Islands is proud to partner with NASA in supporting this effort. It is critical to the Virgin Islands, to this nation, and to the world. I want to first thank NASA for all of the support it has provided down through the years to the University of the Virgin Islands. We would not have a physics program without their support, and we are proud to be one of the few HBCUs in the nation that offer degrees in physics to our students. Second, I want to thank Dr. David Morris, one of our faculty members who has been a pioneer for us in creating the physics program, for taking our observatory, our Edelman Observatory, to an entirely different level, and for all of the work he has done with NASA and forming this partnership. I also want to thank the leaders of our Caribbean Center for Green Technology, Greg Wannell, Ms. Chans, Christina Chans, for their work around climate change, which is a focus of this outreach effort. But more importantly, I want to thank and welcome all of the students who will be participating in this gathering, especially those from the Virgin Islands, who we are very proud to have them participate, but the individuals from around the world who will be participating in this global outreach effort are welcomed and should be applauded. STEM and the development of more talent in STEM fields is not only critical to the growth of this nation, but critical to the growth of the world. We will not be able to provide the leaders for economic development, for innovation, if we do not have the requisite number of students in STEM fields. But it is not just economic development and innovation, but as the COVID pandemic has demonstrated to us, we need individuals who are knowledgeable in the healthcare arena, knowledgeable about infectious diseases and all of the ramifications that come from healthcare challenges. These are STEM fields, and we believe that it is important to inspire students at an early age to get them aware of the various career paths and to pursue these areas. And so finally, I want to just indicate that we are proud to host this event. The university, we pride ourselves in trying to be a leader in STEM development, and not just STEM development in general, but especially among those students and groups who are often absent from STEM fields. Unless we are able to tap into all of the resources that are available in our nation and in the world, we will not be able to meet the challenges that we face. And this gathering and this university and NASA are deeply committed to that vision. Welcome. I hope the next few days will be enlightening, inspiring, and will leave a mark on each of you. Thank you.
I'm Mirza Beg, 18th student, and I love physics.
Hi, I'm Shalani Talama, 8th grade student, and I love biology.
Hi, I'm Sanaya King. I'm an 8th grade student, and I love chemistry.
And we are
the UVI Water Ambassadors and Future Scientists of Adelita Kankrai Junior High School.
My name is Cecile Penn, and I am a science teacher at the Adelita Kankrai Intermediate and Junior High School. I have been involved with UVI and the Water Ambassadors Program for more than 8 years. On behalf of UVI President Dr. Hall, the College of Science and Math, and UVI Caribbean Green Technology Center, we want to welcome our colleagues at school across the territory, nationally and internationally.
Let me bring you on a short tour of St. Thomas Pineapple Point at St. John Trunk Bay, United States, Virgin Islands.
Notice the clear blue seas and the beautiful beaches that describe Hull, Megan's, and Trunk Bay. Join me as I take you on a virtual tour of the USVI. Megan's Bay. The water is usually very calm with no waves of current. Great for floating along and for swimming. The bay deepens gradually from shore, making it perfect for small children. Snorkeling is possible along the rocky coast. However, Megan's Bay is not known for good snorkeling, but for the water sports boat rents, paddle boats, kayaks, and sunfish. Beaches, floats, and snorkel sets are available at the concession. Trunk Bay. Ensconced within U.S. Virgin Islands National Park is Trunk Bay in St. John, USVI. The bay's location within the Virgin Islands National Park ensures that the archipelago remains free of aggressive, unsympathetic development, making it one of the most pristine of all places in the Caribbean. The area consists of 3/10 of a mile-long beach that surrounds a half-moon-shaped body of water.
The U.S. Drought Monitors, which are climatologists, meteorologists, and hydrologists all across the nation who work with researchers at UVI.
The scientists from NOAA, National Weather Service, USDA, and many other who use these baseline indicators of droughts.
You see, in the USVI, many collect water.
To use in their homes for rooftop collection.
What the researchers who review this data see is the stress of vegetation, erosion, and compare these images to others taken over longer periods to determine what the impacts of drought are in the USVI and the region. This helps USDA and the Farm Service Agency aid farmers in the territory when severe drought impacts the island. Right now, we are facing drought conditions, and it appears based on the research here, the territory is headed into an earlier drought season than in years past.
To our fellow future scientists watching today from all across the globe, we hope you enjoy the presentation presented by students across the USVI and the nation as we learn more from NASA scientists about how we as students can join the ranks of NASA and begin our journey to UVI and other universities and study STEM to make this world a better, safer place for all of us.
And now, on to NASA's presentations. Thank you.
Dr. Stacy Klein-Gardner, and I'm an adjunct professor of biomedical engineering at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. I have the pleasure of serving as the co-principal investigator and co-director of the Engineering for Us All project, or E4USA. The E4USA program seeks to demystify and democratize engineering for us all. The overarching goal is to introduce a broad spectrum of students and their teachers to engineering careers through a high school level introductory engineering course. E4USA is so very proud to be represented so strongly today in this wonderful gathering of scientists and engineers. Many thanks to our colleagues at the University of the Virgin Islands for this opportunity. We hope that more high schools around the U.S. will visit our website, e4usa.org, to learn more and consider joining us. Now, off to a wonderful session.
Hi. Let me extend a warm welcome to my fellow scientists and engineers that are joining us today. Greetings from Brentwood High School at Brentwood, Tennessee. We're just south of Nashville. Good to see you all here. We're a proud member of E4USA for the last 3 years, so from its inception. Some of our projects that we work on deal with problems at the school, such as missing locks from the bathroom stalls and how we could possibly lock them for ourselves. Other projects that we work on extend outside of the school through our community partners and partnerships with them, such as with the Nashville Zoo. We're looking forward to spending a little bit of time with you today. Thank you.
Good day, fellow scientists and engineers. Greetings from Brentwood High School, located in Brentwood, Tennessee, just south of Nashville. We are a proud original member of the Engineering for Us All program. Through E4USA, we have learned the importance of the engineering design process, the effectiveness of a strong team dynamic, and the huge impact that creativity has on the entire world.
Right now, we are working on an engineering problem at our own school. Brentwood High School has a separate STEM building from the main high school, so teachers, students, administrators, and SROs have to walk outside on uncovered sidewalks no matter what the weather is. We are interviewing our stakeholders now to make sure we define our problem well. We're planning to address the overall problem using preventative and reactive measures to protect people's belongings.
Before the end of the year, we look forward to solving problems posed by several community partners. We'll create enrichment toys for animals at the Nashville Zoo, design a repair tool for the safety measures around the Nashville Super Speedway track, and solve a problem for the Vanderbilt University Medical Center's Department of Neurosurgery.
Thank you!
All Saints Cathedral School in St. Thomas, U.S. Virgin Islands. I'm the head teacher of the E4USA platform at our school. Our students have taken an engineering journey from day one to where they are now. In this video, they're going to show you where we've gone, what we've done, and what they experienced. There's many great things in E4USA, and our students are more than excited to move forward into engineering, even into the college level where they want to go. So thank you for your time. I hope you enjoy our presentation, and for sure, engineering for all.
My name is Ashwin Kim. I'm a student at Austin Cathedral School. I am in 12th grade, and I really enjoy engineering. Now, let me turn it over to my fellow classmates.
Good morning. My name is Hugh Wing. I'm also a student at Our Saints Cathedral School, and I'm in the 11th grade. And engineering class is the best thing I ever took.
Hello, my name is Isaiah Francis. I'm also a student at Our Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade, and I'm glad I took the class.
This is a video that we made to reflect on our engineering journey.
Here we are, day number three on our table. Our frame is painted. Good morning, how you doing? All right, we're gonna start by using the drill. Go ahead. Oh my God. Good morning, everybody. We are in engineering. Today, we are starting our robot challenge. Everybody's ears are smoking as they start thinking about how this is gonna work.
Good morning. Here we are, engineering class, doing creating a rain shelter. They're brainstorming the process. We will have an update later.
Awesome class. Everybody's hard at work. Oh yeah, this engineering at its best.
Yeah.
and no vibes, them sweet. We stand up and watch the girl, them tweet. What them a bubble and a wine for me tonight. Yeah.
They are struggling. Savannah is struggling. Sophia is struggling how to keep the thing up, but she got hype, but can she do it without holding it? That is the question.
Question. What did you learn from E4USA's robotic arm challenge?
What we learned through the robotic arm challenge is that we needed to complete our objective through set parameters and through our mistakes and failures, we could better design and make the project more stronger and our prototype stronger.
What are some of the things you learned from your failures throughout the robotic arm?
I learned that there is really nothing called failure. With every fail mistake that you make, it helps you improve and better your design to make the final product, to make it even better, stronger, and more efficient. Your project.
How has your initial opinion of engineering changed throughout the year?
My first impression of engineering was that I thought that it was just about wires and hammer and all kind of tools. But when I came to the engineering class, I started learning more about the other type of engineering and how it's everywhere in the world.
One of my names is Manuel Hodge Baines. I attend All Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade. And how can you elaborate and describe the five W's?
First, what we want to look at is the five W's. What, who, where, why, and how. What is the problem at hand? Who is the problem affecting? Where is the problem at? Why, what would we create or enhance a design to fix the problem? And how, through our design process.
Is constructing an underwater turbine ethical?
We have to look through our engineering process to see if it's ethical. And how we're going to do that is by studying the marine life and the people around us to answer that question.
What can we tell you from what we've learned from the robotic arm challenge into real life scenarios?
What we learned from the robotic arm challenge is there's different types of engineering, such as textile, mechanical and structural engineering, which ties into our next project, the underwater turbine.
Could you elaborate on why did you choose to do underwater turbine for your next project?
That's a good question, and that leads into our five W's. For the what is because we need clean energy in the Virgin Islands. For the who is for St. Thomas and St. John. For the where is underwater between St. Thomas and St. John. For the why is because of the constant flow of directional current between St. Thomas and St. John's. And how? That's the question.
What type of engineering do we have to look at when constructing and designing the prototype for an underwater turbine? Could you elaborate?
The different type of engineering we would use is one, textile. We would test and try different type of sealant to see which one is more effective underwater for the underwater turbine. Another type of engineering we would use is mechanical engineering for the mechanical parts that is in the turbine. Another type of engineering we will also use is electrical engineering for all the wires that's in the turbine, and also the wires that are connected to St. Thomas and St. John, which is feeding the energy. And another type of engineering we would also use is structural engineering for the frame and the stand of the underwater turbine to help it lock underwater. And another type of engineering we would use is cooling engineering, which will help us see from outside and above water what's going on to see if the underwater turbines need repair or something went wrong in the turbine.
Hello, I'm NASA astronaut Joe Acaba, coming to you from the Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. I want to thank Dr. David Hall and the University of the Virgin Islands faculty, staff, and students for inviting me to share a few words and for working with my NASA colleagues to plan and organize this week-long event. All of this in the midst of a global pandemic. These challenging times have been difficult, So it's important for all of us to remain optimistic and resilient. Despite all, here at NASA, we continue to advance the research and technology to return to the moon. We are still pushing forward with plans to send the first woman and first person of color to the moon under NASA's Artemis program. No human has set foot on the moon since Apollo 17 in 1972. So the possibility of landing on the moon is incredible. As a young kid of Puerto Rican descent, I was born and raised in Southern California. I've always enjoyed math and science, but my interest in becoming an astronaut started with my grandfather. He had old films of the Apollo missions, which we enjoyed watching together. I've been fortunate to have so many mentors who supported me and motivated me to be where I am today. Prior to joining NASA, I served as a member of the United States Marine Corps Reserves. I also spent 2 years as a volunteer in the United States Peace Corps. I worked a lot of different jobs until I found the one that I thought and still believe is the most important job on the planet, and that was being a school teacher. For 5 years, I taught math and science to both middle and high school students in Florida. When I became an astronaut, the International Space Station became my classroom. This allowed me to share my love for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics with students around the world. My hope are to inspire the next generation of explorers and leaders and to elevate and highlight the teaching profession and its importance to our society. As you learn more about NASA and all that we do, I want you to remember you are a lot like an astronaut aboard the space station right now. As a result of COVID restrictions, many of you are feeling somewhat isolated and forced to interact virtually with family and friends. But hang in there. Your mission is to remain optimistic and resilient. Before signing off, I want to give a shout out to the USVI teachers, faculty, students, and staff, and all of those nationally and internationally who are joining us from as far away as Hawaii, Tennessee, the Eastern Caribbean, South Africa, India, and Scotland. And finally, to the student presenters from the USVI Cancrine Junior High School, All Saints School, Gift Hill, and Brentwood High School in Tennessee. Thanks for sharing your vision and science with us.
Good morning. On behalf of the University of the Virgin Islands College of Science and Math and Caribbean Green Technology, we'd like to welcome you to this outreach event featuring NASA and NASA scientists. First up is Dr. Samuel Garcia. Dr. Garcia, take it away.
Hi, good morning. Can you hear me clearly?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you very much, Christina, and all those students that are joining us. It is truly an honor and a privilege to be here with you today. And so we're excited. We know that there are so many young people doing amazing things and teachers that are helping you to learn all the different skill sets that we need to make this world a more livable, sustainable planet. And so this is a great time to be a young person exploring different career paths and opportunities, not only with us at NASA, although we really want you to come with us at NASA, but there are so many different other industries that you can participate in. So the potential benefits for you are tremendous, right? And so we just want to come and speak to you and tell you a little bit about some of the work that we're doing at NASA and some of the opportunities that await for you as you grow older and make your own career pathway as a professional. So I think just 1 second, hopefully my presentation is visible. Okay, can you all see that?
Yeah, we can see it. It looks like you just need to present, like go into your presentation mode.
Gotcha. Okay, let me hit it one more time. Okay, so that. How's that, Zach? Can you see my presentation now?
No, it looks black for me for some reason.
What? Okay. Okay, so.
Oh, unless you have a video. If you have a video, that might be the reason. Are you opening up with the videos, Dr. Garcia?
No, I am not. I'm just starting off with my presentation. It says explore student opportunities at NASA. Yeah, I think you should be able to see it now, right?
Yeah, there it goes. Perfect.
Okay. Awesome. So just a little bit about me. My name is Samuel Garcia. I am an education specialist here at NASA Kennedy Space Center. And my job is to get students and teachers and, you know, the public excited about what NASA is doing. We know that NASA is doing tremendous things, different missions, and you hear about us in the news. And then we have teams of, you know, individuals that make up teams like myself who get to share and engage and just provide all these different learning opportunities for the public. So my job is to carry this to the classrooms, to the homes, to the communities, and just help nurture, inspire future generations of STEM professionals. And so I was born and raised in Texas. I am a first generation college student. I was a former educator before transitioning into an education specialist with NASA. And so for the past almost 5 years now, I've been, you know, I've had the opportunity to work at the Jet Propulsion Lab prior to coming to Kennedy Space Center. I've done, you know, live chats with different subject matter experts. I visited Puerto Rico, you know, to conduct, you know, that's me in the upper left-hand corner, facilitate teacher training and workshops, meet astronauts. As you see, Frank Rubio, he's one of the Artemis generation astronauts. And then, you know, and all these other wonderful things, you know, go to Disney World as part of my job, because we at Disney, you know, they, of course, we're so close to Orlando here. And so they invited us to come and see, you know, some of the technology they use for their rides and their amusement and attractions. So it was a great learning experience. But at the end of the day, you know, it's always an educational process. And without education, without educators, we wouldn't have the professionals that we have today. So I encourage you to explore all these different opportunities that I'm going to speak to you about. But don't never rule out, you know, becoming an educator, because we desperately need individuals that have a passion to serve others, and then, of course, train and educate and prepare future professionals. So at NASA, NASA stands for the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. We have a long history. We have a long history dating back to 1958. And prior to that, it was we were focused on aeronautics. It used to be NACA before it became NASA, NASA. So NACA was transitioned to NASA, where we focused not only on aeronautics, but also on space exploration. And so we see this wonderful image here of the Apollo 11 Saturn V rocket as it's being rolled out from the Vehicle Assembly Building back in 1969. And here at Kennedy Space Center, one interesting fact is that we are celebrating our 60th anniversary. So we have 60 years of just historic, groundbreaking achievements. And, you know, so we look to the past and remember our legacy, but then we also look to the present and the future. And so this future for young students, it is so bright beyond your imagination. And so what I'll share today and what our other guest speaker will share is that, you know, there are numerous opportunities, profound opportunities for you to become and be a part of this Artemis generation that we'll speak about. We can't forget about our environment and climate science. And so NASA also focuses, you know, heavily on Earth science. We have so many different types of satellites and instruments on the ground in space that are constantly monitoring and observing our planet. And so we do our best to track changes in different areas of our Earth system, because we know that Earth systems are all a part of one bigger, broader interconnected system. So we at NASA, we try to truly understand how it all relates and connects and affect one another, right? And so we saw those young people in these videos learning about the planet, you know, getting out into the community, learning about their environment and find ways to address issues. And that's what we want. We want to cultivate, you know, this appreciation for knowledge and figuring out solutions to issues. And so we at NASA take great pride in promoting missions and projects and programs that help us live and improve the way we live here on Earth. We also have, you know, modern missions, such as the James Webb Space Telescope, that are, you know, revolutionary in nature. They, you know, this particular mission and this observatory will radically change what we know and understand about our universe. And so we need young minds to help us develop new technologies that will take us even further than what we're currently doing now. And of course, the next bold next step in human space exploration is Artemis. And my colleague will talk more in depth about Artemis, but this is a rocket. This is the rocket that will be launching humans back to the moon as we look forward to not only returning to the moon, but stay there and learn from it and be able to create, you know, the sustainable, the infrastructure, the technology that will then allow us to transport humans and cargo to Mars. And so this is Artemis. This is the Artemis generation. You are the part of this unique chapter in history. We heard our astronaut Joe Acaba talk about when he was young, his grandfather showed him videos of the Apollo missions. And that hasn't been done in almost 50 years since the last astronaut stepped foot on the moon. But now with Artemis, a new chapter begins. And now we will see our team of astronauts, you know, step foot on the moon. And this time they're not gonna be only males and former military individuals, but, you know, now we have this wonderful team of, you know, men and women from all over, you know, the country, from different backgrounds, with different disciplines, like Joe Acaba, who is a former educator. And you know, we have geologists, we have medical doctors, you know, you name it. We have a very diverse team of astronauts. So within this rank, we will see one of these prospective women to become the first female and the first person of color to step foot on the moon, which is truly, truly exciting. So I encourage you to read them. Read more about their profiles, get to know some of their interests, their hobbies, because anything that you can truly learn, you can apply it to yourself. You don't have to learn wonder, you know, how can I become an astronaut? You can take the lessons, you can read about them, you can study them and see what makes them unique, and you can work towards diversifying your skill sets, such as these individuals that you see on the screen. And so career path, right? It's exciting to be part of the space industry, no doubt. We see a team here of engineers who have worked on the Perseverance rover that landed last year on Mars. And so, you know, we like to have fun. We have a lot of fun at NASA, right? So our astronauts, I imagine there are many, many young students who have a deep passion for space exploration and who are fearless and brave and, you know, want to really explore what it's like to be in space. And so, I mean, chances are within your lifetime, you have a great, great opportunities to do that, not only with us at NASA, but also in the private industry as we start seeing more and more individuals go up to space. But our astronauts are an important part of our team here at NASA, but they're not the only individuals, of course, that work with us at NASA. Hold on. My screen is frozen. Hey, guys, can you hear me?
Yep, we can hear you.
Okay, for some reason, my screen just froze on me. I have no idea what's going on.
You might need to just go ahead and exit out of the PowerPoint if you can and restart it.
Okay, sorry about that. The mouse is not responding. I have no idea what's going on. But it's all right. I always have a backup. So I'll run it from my second computer here. No worries. So as I was mentioning, our astronauts are currently preparing for a trip to the moon. And we have so many different things, so many different opportunities. Yeah, my mouse just stopped working, Zach. So if we can...
Well, if you'd like, you can speak without the charts, or it's up, yeah, to, it's up to you. Or it's up, yeah, to, it's up to you.
I can do that. I can do that. I can do that. Another feedback. Okay, so I'm going to make one last modification here. Sorry, guys. See if this works. Okay. So hopefully this works. And so you should be able to see that. And sorry about that.
Yes, it looks good.
Okay, wonderful. And so we continue. And what I wanted to just really emphasize to the young students is that, you know, when we think of NASA, we want you to think not only in terms of STEM, but we want you to think in terms of non-STEM, right? And the only individuals that, and sometimes we have a perception of who can do STEM and what it looks like, and that you need, you know, super advanced degrees to do with the jobs that we do. And that's true to a certain extent, but then we have all these other amazing, talented individuals who got to NASA through different pathways. And so we have technicians, we have opportunities for internships. Beginning at the age of 16, you can apply for an internship with us at NASA. And then we have, of course, all these, you know, wonderful other individuals that help us do the amazing work that we do. So social media experts, astronaut trainers, all these different types of designers. And so it's really finding your passion, right? And so if we have artists in the room, we always want to make space for the arts, because that type of thinking is really unique, and our artists think in very, very divergent types of ways. And so our artists here at NASA help us paint all these amazing visuals of different places. So you see here, you have Mars, Earth, one of the Titans, the moons, Europa, which is one of the moons that we will be visiting in the near future in our solar system. And so we need artists, we need help individuals that can apply their skill sets to help us envision some of these places that we haven't visited yet. And therefore, you know, our artists contribute their skills by creating mission patches as the ones you see above. These are some of the iconic Apollo missions. The first one, Apollo 17, that's actually the last mission to the moon. And so our artists lend their skill sets to, you know, just helping us tell the NASA story, but also utilizing their skills to engage the audience, right, and learn more about it. And so without the arts, space exploration wouldn't be the same, that's for sure, because our artists are busy working, creating this type of content for the public and to help capture the imagination and also engage with us more at NASA. Our educators also play a critical, vital role. So at NASA, we also have educators and teachers that work with teachers and students. And then lastly, our students. So we'd be remiss if we don't mention how important students and valuable contributors students are to us here at NASA. And so we highly encourage students to apply for our internships beginning at the age of 16. You know, then this way you get training, you get to work with mentors, you get, you know, this really rich experience that I think would only help boost your confidence in whatever discipline that you're in. Another way to get involved with us is participating in these Artemis Student Challenges. So within Artemis, we have amazing, amazing opportunities. And so these are some of the challenges that go live and that you want to be a part of and make sure you join. There are two specifically that are open to middle school and high school students, which is a Human Exploration Rover Challenge and the Student Launch. So those are competitions that are available for, you know, non-university students as well as university students. And then we have all these other ones. You can help us design spacesuits. You can help us build, for example, here at Kennedy Space Center, we have the Lunabotics competition, and now there's a Lunabotics Junior. And so this is where you create a robot to help simulate an off-world lunar mining mission, right? Because part of our work or part of the Artemis mission is to help develop and utilize the resources that are on the moon, on the surface of the moon. So we need technology to help us to do that. So I encourage you to learn more about these challenges, plan ahead, because these deadlines come up sometime around the summer, August, September. So talk to your teacher or to your parent and see how you can get involved in some of these challenges.
Hi, my name is Claudia Bernier.
My name is Matthew.
Mi nombre es Miguel Marcelino.
My name is Ali Hyder.
Hi, Kos.
Christine.
Tashir Makia.
Kos Catalano.
Tess Von Ruden.
My name is Sarah Adebumi, and I am a NASA intern.
Jesse Moody, and I'm a NASA intern.
Pathways Engineering intern.
I'm a NASA intern.
I'm a NASA intern at NASA Kennedy Space Center.
Oh, my God.
At Goddard Space Flight Center.
OZ Department at Johnson Space Center.
Of the Human Factors Engineering Team at the Marshall Space Flight Center.
My name is Tina Schirmer, and I'm a Pathways.
At Goddard Space Flight Center.
OZ Department at Johnson Space Center.
Of the Human Factors Engineering Team at the Marshall Space Flight Center.
My name is Tina Schirmer, and I'm a Pathways intern at NASA's Glenn Research Center.
I'm Jamarius Reed, and I'm a NASA intern for the Office of STEM Engagement, working in the Aeronautics Directorate at NASA Ames Research Center.
My name is Courtney Goldman, and I'm a NASA OSIN intern at a Kennedy Space Center.
I'm currently working with the Psychophysiology Research Lab.
I study how nitrogen functions in extreme environments.
In bioinformatics for spacecraft production.
The synthesis analysis of multidimensional ozone measurements.
I supported the X-59 Quest low-boom flight demonstrator project.
I decided to apply to a NASA internship because it sounded like the chance of a lifetime to work alongside the innovators and pioneers at NASA.
We get invited to lectures from astronauts, inspiring researchers, and get to hear about smaller missions that I wouldn't have known about.
And being able to work with all of the amazing people here has truly been out of this world.
I like feeling like I'm contributing to something bigger than just me.
All the different projects that they're funding or different projects that they're investing their resources in is really inspiring.
And NASA did an excellent job providing me with meaningful work and making sure that everyone on the team felt included and involved.
From daily or weekly check-ins, my mentors guided and advised me through my projects and any help that I needed.
I feel that NASA is a source of innovation and inspiration for people of all ages and backgrounds.
But you're also around people that are humble, driven, again, passionate, really coming to work, wanting to work, because they care so much about this goal, this mission.
And all NASA wants to see is that you share that passion as well.
Always remain persistent. Everything doesn't happen the moment you want it to happen. Everything happens when it's supposed to happen. So if you apply 2 or 3 times and you don't get accepted, keep trying.
We are the Artemis Generation, and I am proud and so grateful to take part in getting the next man and the first woman to the moon.
NASA welcomes everyone. It welcomes you.
If you're interested in NASA at all, apply online today. I did not think that I could get an internship with NASA, but I applied anyway, and so I think you should too.
So yes, we want you to apply. We want you to look at this, and we want you to draw Artemis. We want you to apply. And remember, we encourage you not only if you follow a STEM degree, but also make sure to apply if you have a non-STEM degree as well. It's always worth a shot because you never know if you'll get selected. And lastly, we leave you with this opportunity is to draw Artemis by visiting this link and, of course, sharing your work with us at NASA and our social media channels by using this hashtag, Draw Artemis. And then are you ready to join our crew? Because we need you. We need you to think creatively. We need you to apply your skill sets. And of course, we need your talents to help us reach this destinations we can only dream of. So that concludes my presentation and look forward to answering questions at the conclusion of today's session. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Garcia. And I think we're going to get right into our next presenter. Now we have Olivia Fuentes, who is going to be presenting next.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Are you sharing, Zach?
Yep, I'm going to share right now.
Okay, thanks.
Can you see the screen?
Not yet.
No. There you go.
Yeah, it looks like there's just a little bit of lag today.
Are you seeing the screen? I'm not seeing the screen.
Yes. It's your bio education slide.
Olivia, is it still not showing up? I can try and reshare.
Yes, please, if you don't mind. Thank you so much. Well, while he's trying to bring it back up here, let me just go ahead and introduce myself. My name is Olivia Fuentes. I was born and raised in Miami, Florida. I am the daughter of Cuban immigrants. First to go to college in my family. I have two older siblings, but I was the one that had the opportunity to go to college. I graduated from Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University with a bachelor's in aerospace engineering and went ahead and got my master's in technical management several years later while I was working in the industry. I've been working for NASA over 20 years. I started as a contractor for Lockheed Martin, and I had a wonderful career working on a variety of different flight hardware, supporting shuttle, later the International Space Station, supporting different payloads, supported a lot of the astronauts and the payloads that they did or the experiments that they interfaced with. And later I was able to move over to the Orion program, which is obviously what we're going to be launching and talking about today for Artemis, but I got an opportunity to start there at the ground floor in Houston and later moved here to Kennedy Space Center where I continued supporting that program. I was lucky enough to join NASA as a NASA employee over a year ago, and I'm currently working as a ground integration systems engineer at the Vertical Assembly Building. I have three children with my husband, Gil, a senior, a sophomore, and a four-year-old, and I have been talking and providing STEM talks since my kids were in pre-K. So I fully support STEM, fully support all kids pursuing science, math, technology, and engineering type roles. I think we need more more involved in this field. So with that, let's go to the next slide, please. And so with Artemis, our new program, we're going to be going to the moon and beyond. And I'm going to get started with a video that I would like to introduce you with so that I can introduce you to Artemis. Let's get the video started.
In 1968-72, America launched 9 human missions to the moon, 6 of which successfully touched down, allowing 12 men to walk on the lunar surface. NASA's next chapter of lunar exploration, called Artemis, has the task of not just going to the moon to create a long-term human presence on and around it, but also to prepare for ever more complex human missions to Mars. In short, everything we must be able to do here, we must first do here. So, what will an Artemis mission look like? Everything is designed and tested with our most important element in mind, the astronauts. This is their deep space, human-rated spacecraft called Orion, built in 3 parts. The crew module, where up to 4 astronauts will live and work throughout the flight. The service module, with life support systems for the crew and its own engine and fuel reserves. And a launch abort system, with engines capable of pulling the crew module to safety during launch should anything go wrong. To accomplish the task of launching our crew in heavy payloads, NASA is building the Space Launch System, comprising of a cargo hold, an exploration upper stage, a massive core stage, and 2 extended solid rocket boosters. Altogether, this is the world's most powerful rocket, and it exceeds the legendary Saturn V of the Apollo era in numerous ways. Sitting on the launch pad, the entire rocket, fully fueled, weighs just over 6 million pounds, 5.2 million of which is just the fuel. Once ignited, there is no stopping what comes next. All 4 RS-25 engines and the 2 solid rocket boosters come to life, thundering our crew upwards. 2 minutes after ignition, the solid rocket boosters are spent and released. 8 minutes after launch, the core stage is depleted and separated. The upper stage fires briefly, placing Orion into a parking orbit around the Earth. Here, the crew reconfigure the spacecraft and check systems to confirm everything is ready for deep space travel. With a go from mission control, the crew reignite the exploration upper stage engines to leave Earth entirely. The exact timing of this maneuver is critical to reach a speed that can escape Earth's gravitational pull, but also put Orion on a course that will intersect the moon days later. Once this burn is complete, the upper stage of the SLS is jettisoned and the crew aboard Orion coast for several days toward all that awaits them at the moon. Approaching the moon, we see the fundamental differences between Artemis and Apollo. Instead of requiring Orion to serve as an expendable lunar command module or to carry a constrained lunar lander, the Artemis missions will take advantage of a different approach, pre-staging. Everything needed for lunar missions will be positioned in advance by commercial and international partners. This includes rovers, science experiments, and human-rated systems on the surface. But it also includes a dedicated lunar station in orbit around the moon called Gateway. Here at this station, we can pre-stage a robust lunar lander and establish a strong communications relay. Designed with open standards, the Gateway can be expanded as new missions and partnerships develop, allowing multiple human missions on the moon at the same time and enabling ongoing science to be conducted even between human missions. The Gateway is also capable of adjusting its orbit to allow access to every part of the moon, something the Apollo missions could not do. But the real key in this approach is placing Gateway in a unique halo orbit to perfect the maneuvers needed for Mars missions. And with the growing list of commercial and international opportunities, Gateway is the ideal hub between Earth and all that lies beyond. Returning to our crew as they approach Gateway, the Orion must match the elliptical orbit of the station in order to successfully dock. Once on board, pre-selected crew members transfer to the lunar lander, while those assigned to Gateway remain on station. The lunar lander system itself is built for 3 unique steps. Descending from the halo orbit of Gateway down to a low lunar orbit, descending from low lunar orbit to the surface, and once the lunar mission is complete, launching from the surface of the moon and ascending all the way back to the orbiting Gateway. Once back aboard the Orion spacecraft and undocked from Gateway, the crew fire their engine once to break out of the halo orbit and once again to sling the spacecraft around the moon, placing it on a multi-day trajectory back towards Earth. As they near the end of this journey, the service module is released, and the crew module is oriented heat shield first. Entering Earth's atmosphere at 25,000 miles per hour, the friction of air slows Orion considerably, while also subjecting it to temperatures of 5,000 degrees. With the Orion now at just 300 miles per hour, a series of parachutes uniquely tested and produced for this moment deploy, decelerating the craft to just 20 miles per hour for splashdown. With each successful mission, Artemis ushers in the next wave of men and women to explore our moon and prove that together we are ready to go beyond.
Great. Let's go to the next. Okay, so so I work for the NASA, National Aeronautics and Space Administration, and let's go to the next one, please.
Sorry, I think the lag is kind of, which one did you want, the NASA slide?
The Artemis 1 flight test. I think it's the next one. And we apologize for the lag. Sometimes technology can be a little challenging.
Is it still not showing up for you?
No.
Oh, man.
It's one of those days.
Yeah, this is like a 30-second lag.
Wow.
I can try and reshare and disconnect from.
Oh, there it is. It just came up. It just came
okay.
up. So we know it's going to take a minute. But that video that we showed shows what we're planning to do with Artemis across all of the different flights. But I wanted to give you a quick introduction of what we're doing and getting ready for this upcoming launch. And someone asked specifically, when are we launching? And I don't know what our latest date is, but it's going to be coming up either at the end of February or beginning of March. But let me walk you really quickly. We're going to be launching out of here, out of Cape Canaveral, going around the Earth, where we're going to be deploying a series of CubeSats on this mission. But this flight test is going to allow us to check out all of our systems on this vehicle before we launch any crew in it. So once we launch, we start heading out to the moon and we start coming into the orientation that's going to allow us to capture the moon, go around. We're going to do a few circles around the moon, do all of our testing that we need to do, and then we're going to come back using the moon to come back around and get away from the moon's atmosphere area and head towards back towards Earth and delivering us with the parachutes back in the ocean so that we can be retrieved. We'll be landing on the west coast of California, where a naval ship will be waiting for us to be able to collect the crew module and recover it in that naval ship. And all of the naval portion of it has been practiced with previous earlier flights that we did, the engineering flight test that we did about 5 years ago. So we have gone through initial testing with the spacecraft and going around the moon. Now we're going to go all the way, going around the Earth. Now we're going to go all the way to the moon on this next test. And we are supposed to be launching, I just heard back, on March 12th. So March 12th is the next launch for this Artemis 1 flight test that's going to take us to the moon. Go ahead to the next one, Zach.
You you might just need to lead in, like, just keep talking and it'll show up eventually.
Sure. So the next picture that you're going to see here is going to be our exploration ground system, the space launch system, and the Orion. That is what is used or comprised to be able to do this Artemis 1 launch. The exploration ground system team is who I work for, and we provide all of the structure leading and all of the ground support equipment leading to launch. So we're the ones that get everything ready, provide all of the testing, do all of the integration, and then get it ready over to the launch pad to launch. The SLS, which is the Space Launch System, is the most powerful rocket in the world. And Orion is going to be our deep space human-rated command module where we're going to be launching our crew in. That's how we plan to get to the moon. So we can probably hope it comes up here momentarily. I'm surprised for the lag that we're having, but it's okay. So the next chart I wanted to talk to you about is the vertical assembly building. That is the building that I support as a ground integration engineer. And the VAB covers about 8 acres. It's 525 feet tall and 518 feet wide. That is where we are going to be doing, or where we are assembling the SLS rocket along with Orion at the top. Adjacent to the vertical assembly building to the right is the launch control center, which will be depicted in the picture when it comes up. The launch control center conducted all of the unmanned Apollo for all the way through Saturn launches in November 9th, 1967. That was the first launch that we did supporting using the LCC. The crawler transporter is approximately 6.6 million pounds. There it is. And weighs, or the weight of about 15 Statues of Liberty, or about 1,000 pickup trucks, if you can imagine that. It's able to transport 18 million pounds, which is about 20 fully loaded 777 airplanes. And the mobile launcher, which you see in the blue towards the back right, that is where we actually stack the SLS. It's about 350 feet tall, 662 steps, and weighs about 10.5 million pounds. And that sits on top of the crawler, which we pull into the vertical assembly building. Now, here you see the vertical assembly building. It was constructed back in 1965. On the left-hand side, you see the mobile launcher coming into the vertical assembly building. The inside is the actual platforms. Those platforms were modified to support the new SLS and Orion configuration for Artemis. And on the right-hand side, you actually see the rocket that we're planning to launch in March. The orange that you see below in about the midway point is the SLS, and the two white stacks on either side are the solid rocket boosters. And all the way at the very top, that's Orion with the launch abort system coming out from the very, very top of the last platform. So it's an exciting time at NASA with this space exploration mission getting ready to launch. We are currently building this up in High Bay 3. There are four high bays inside of two on the east side and two on the west side of this building. And each side has 456 foot high bay doors, which enable us to drive in and out these large rockets. And they're used to vertically stack everything and roll them out to the launch pad. The SLS rocket, like I said, is going to be rolled out to the pad for a test here soon, called wet dress. And we actually roll it all the way to the pad 39B for for the test, and then we bring it all the way back into the vertical assembly building. And that's going to be happening here shortly. Next. So I was mentioning the crawler. The crawler is an incredible machine. It is huge, able to carry. It's been around for about 50 years, and it's about the size of a baseball infield. And it's powered by locomotive and large electrical power generator engines. So it's incredible. It must travel on top. It's so heavy, it must travel on top of a road of stones. These stones, as the crawler goes from the vertical assembly building to launch pad 39, after so many passes over the stones, they actually have to refurbish because it crushes the stone. So those stones have to be replaced occasionally because of the weight, depending on how often we are going to pass the crawler over the stones. Next. So the mobile launcher is a two-story base that has a platform for the rocket, as you can see there, and the tower is equipped with all the connection lines, the umbilicals that provide all of the utilities into the launch vehicle, all the launch accessories that have to be provided to SLS and Orion, like power, communication, coolant, fuel, and stabilization prior to launch. So on the left, you see the mobile launcher sitting at the pad, and in the middle, that very top arm, that is the crew access arm, and that is how the crew is going to go in and access the very top where we load the crew into the Orion before launch. Next. This is Charlie Blackwell Thompson. We are very excited to have our first female launch director. She will be directing this Artemis launch in March and all of the upcoming Artemis launches. We are very excited to have Charlie heading our launches for Artemis. She is amazing. She supports the work out of the Launch Control Center overseeing these launches. This is a four-story facility that was constructed in the southeast corner by the vertical assembly building and overseeing the Launch Complex 39 area, where our launch pad A and B are located, which has a great view from there so that they can control all systems and all things that are going on at the pad. And we also oversee, using the Launch Control Center, oversee all the testing that gets done in the vertical assembly building. So all throughout the firing room, which is what you see there on the right below, is where all testing, everyone has an assigned area and they're continuously doing a variety of different ground tests and flight tests, and everything is conducted out of this LCC facility all the way through launch. The pad that you see here has been upgraded. The yellow that you see are the flame detectors. In the yellow, those new flame, deflectors are a critical part of the system to keep the plume exhaust from the massive rocket during launch, so it safely contains that. The area to the bottom left in blue is a construction of 1.4 million liquid hydrogen storage sphere, and that is going to be supporting the upcoming Artemis flights. And then on the top right, you see those white beams at the very top. Those go above where the rocket would be because those are our lightning protection system towers. They stand about 600 feet tall, and they are there to prevent lightning strikes at the pad. Next. So here is just to walk you through really quickly. At the very bottom, you have the RS-25 main engines that are on the SLS. You have the two solid rocket boosters that are white on the sides, the core stage and vehicle avionics, the launch vehicle stage adapter in the middle, the interim cryogenic propulsion system that you see there in the middle, the Orion stage adapter, and then the actual Orion multipurpose crew vehicle with the launch abort system being that white cone that's at the very, very top. That's what composes our vehicle. So a little bit about the RS-25 engines. There are 2 5-segment solid rocket boosters. They provide 512,000 pounds of thrust. So the operational thrust is about 109%, and they operate for about 8 minutes. And it is operating up to 6,000 degrees Fahrenheit. So they're very powerful, incredible engines. Next. Here, they test the solid rocket boosters at one of our facilities. They stand about 17 stories tall and burn about approximately 6 tons of propellant every second. So that each booster generates more than 14 four-engine jumbo commercial airliners, just to give you an idea. Next. So the SLS core stage is about 65 meters, so 212 feet long, and about 27.6 feet in diameter. And mount the main propulsion system that incorporates 4 of these RS-25 engines at the bottom. And this was built out at Stennis Space Center, where they did all of the testing before it was put on a barge and brought here to Kennedy Space Center, where we accepted it into the vertical assembly building for integration. Next. So here is the launch abort system that I was talking about. It's positioned on top of the Orion crew module, as you see on the left-hand side there. That is in another one of our facilities at the launch assembly. So at that facility, we go ahead and put on the adapter at the top. It's designed to protect our astronauts in case of a problem from the time they're on the ground to the time they launch, before they go into the actual orbit, they can actually abort our crew and bring them safely down to the ground. The launch abort system abort motor generates about enough thrust to lift about 26 elephants off the ground. It is incredible, and it's able to be guided back to the ground. So we're able to bring our astronauts safely down in case there's an emergency anywhere along the launch path. Next. So Orion will be the most advanced spacecraft ever designed and carry astronauts further into space than ever before. It will sustain our astronauts in space travel and provide a safe reentry from deep space and an emergency abort capability. Apollo had an abort capability, but it was very, very limited, and it was designed after we had the problem with the first Apollo 1 on the pad. The service module provides primary power and propulsion components until it's discarded at the end of each mission. So if you see on the left-hand side, you see the crew module at the very top, and the service module is the portion below. That is providing all the commodities and power to the vehicle where the crew is sitting, including the environmental control life support system. Next. Here is the second stage of NASA's SLS, which is the initial unmanned flights. So this is basically the interim cryogenic propulsion stage, and this is planned to boost the Orion capsule into the orbital attitude or pointing direction that it needs to head to go to the moon before the manned flights begin. So NASA plans to replace this particular unit with a newly designed second stage booster once we have crew in the vehicle. Next. And so here is what the flight would look like. This is a representation of what our flight will be come March for Orion, for SLS, for Artemis 1. So that is all I have for today for our presentation. I hope you've enjoyed it, and I hope we've provided enough information. If you have any questions, please let me know.
We have a couple questions in the chat. Dr. Garcia and Zach, do you want to come on? Dr. Morris, I don't know if you're still on, but if so, we have one question from the E4USA folks. Oh, goodness, hang on. I just had it. Hang on, I'm going up. So how many, do you guys know how many scientists and engineers are working on the Artemis project at all of the NASA sites combined? Thinking it takes a village, can you let us know ballpark? Is every center and contractor working on it, or is it a select team?
So I will take a shot at maybe answering that. So we have, this is comprised of multiple NASA centers all supporting the Artemis mission, along with over 50 contractors across the entire United States. And so it is an incredible feat of how many different contractors have come together, NASA centers have come together, all to design, integrate, test, and now getting ready to fly our Artemis 1 flight test to the moon. And we were able to successfully do the previous flight back about 5 years ago for the engineering flight test, and now we're getting ready to go to the moon and circle that. And it's an incredible effort across the United States and across our partners with the European Space Agency that did the service module. So a lot of work has come into the integration of all of this equipment coming together. But I don't have a specific figure of a number of people, unless anyone on the call does.
Okay. It's definitely in the thousands, that's for sure.
Awesome. Thanks, Zach. So Ms. D. Cristofano would like to know if what is the most exciting technological innovation or solution that you as a team at NASA have experienced or developed with Artemis? So what's the most exciting innovation or solution encountered in the program development? Can we just say everything?
Olivia, if you have a particular unique experience for your area of work, we'd love to hear that.
Yes. Yeah, so what I was going to mention, I think that there's an incredible amount of new technology that has been incorporated, from the engines to, you know, building the biggest and most powerful rocket to that we have in existence today. But on the Orion side, the launch abort system is quite a system that has been designed to deliver our astronauts safely away from danger, anywhere from the time that they're sitting on the pad to that entire trajectory going into space, but prior to entering orbit, that they're able to eject those astronauts back to Earth using those rocket engines that are at the very top. If you see that picture behind Zach on the left, and you see those four powerful engines that are there, they're able to abort, get away from the rocket, and then it has enough guidance. It has a guidance and navigation system that can actually navigate that vehicle away and land it safely about a mile away and get it out of harm's way. So I think that's an amazing feat that we didn't have before to save our astronauts during launch. So I think that's a pretty amazing thing.
One last question before we close out. What specific missions might NASA be working on when today's elementary students are launching their careers? So let's say in 10 to 15 years, what do you think NASA might be working on? Where will we be jetting off to?
Well, hopefully we will be underway with the Gateway system that was shown in the video. So we plan to be working on the Gateway and providing those different capabilities on the moon. By then, I'm hoping that we have different systems on the moon, that we've been able to fly and take equipment to the moon and start staging all of the different capabilities that we plan to have there. So there will be a lot of work underway in 10 to 15 years to support all of the efforts that we want to accomplish up on the moon.
Awesome. And Dr. Morris, would you like to close us out this afternoon?
Yeah, I'll be happy to. Thank you, Christina. And thank you to all of our NASA colleagues and friends for coming to present this morning, now afternoon. I've been saying at each one of these sessions that I'm just so excited to see how large this event has grown to. We've been doing this for 7 years, and it's grown from a visit by a handful of NASA flight engineers from Kennedy coming down and speaking at a couple of schools in St. Thomas to now, you know, we've had so many great faces from all over NASA Kennedy and lots of different parts of the Space Launch System team. And it's just amazing to see. So thank you very much, Olivia, for presenting. And thank you, of course, Zach and Dr. Garcia for presenting. On the other side, it's so exciting to see how many students we're reaching on all three islands in the USVI and all of the sort of international friends and collaborators that we had joining us from the E4USA program and schools from all around the world. So this is really amazing. The sort of visibility that it gives to the USVI in terms of the work that we do with NASA is amazing. And for our students, I think for you all, I hope we're getting a bit of a better understanding that this really is something that NASA is both eager to have you come do. And I want to make sure you realize that this is something that USVI students are doing right now. We have been sending students from UVI's physics, computer science, biology, mathematics, engineering programs. We've been sending those students to NASA centers for 7 years now, and we've sent more and more students each year. So this is absolutely something that students in your schools, maybe in your families, have done. And we'd love to have some of you guys be the next NASA interns. And I'll just finish that thought by saying that it doesn't have to end with internships either. We've been doing this for 7 years now, and some of the students that learned about these opportunities in sessions just like this, just like you're learning about today, some of those students have come to UVI, worked through our programs, gone and done NASA internships in the summer, and now some of them are even accepting job offers at NASA centers. So this is really a career pathway that clearly NASA is passionate about. That's why they come back and do this with us every year. We're passionate about it at UVI. We think it's a fantastic opportunity for you all to learn a little bit about the bigger world of aerospace engineering and aerospace science, if that's something you're interested in. And I hope you guys are seeing that this really is something that you all can do. So if you'd like to learn more about how you can get plugged into these NASA opportunities, please reach out to Christina Chanis, reach out to myself. Happy to give you all the information that we can to tell you how you can become one of these NASA interns and chart your path to a career at NASA. So with that, I just want to close by saying a huge thank you to Christina. So Christina Chanis, without all of her tremendous effort in lining up all the fantastic speakers that you've heard from today, this really wouldn't happen. And we certainly wouldn't be reaching all of the great audience that we have today. So Christina, thank you so much. I know the students and teaching professionals, thank you. I know our NASA colleagues, thank you. And heartfelt thanks. Thank you so much for putting all this together. And thank you again to all of our NASA colleagues and to all of you, the USVI students who have been joining us today. Thank you so much. I look forward to seeing you in our research programs and at UVI and in these NASA centers in the future. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We'll see you all at 1 o'clock. And for those of you who live in the cold weather states, remember it is about 87 degrees, beautiful, breezy. And yes, the ocean is beautiful blue. Come join us.
You're just rubbing it in.
I am. Oh, that's snow. I want to ski and you want to surf, so let's trade. See you at the 1 o'clock hour, everyone. Thank you.
All right. Thank you all.
Dream big, everyone. Awesome. Bye-bye.
Thank you all. Take care.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Miss Olivia. You were awesome.
Oh, anytime.
Yeah, thank you.